violence and aggression in Israel-Palestine, countries struggling with rising COVID-19 numbers, anti-Asian racism and violence at an all-time high, strained relationships as politics not only shapes our news but also divides our families, lockdowns not yet lifted, and it's been cold and gray and rainy. It's been easy to give up hope. But then creation speaks. All of a sudden, the grass is not only growing, it's taking over. The days are longer and warmer. Gardening is no longer a hopeful act. It is part of the dance. Spring has come. No matter how long the winter, spring will always come. New life, new hope. Welcome to worship with Jubilee United Church. If this is your first time with us, or if you've been with us forever, it helps to know a little bit about what we believe. We don't all believe the same things. We don't all speak about God or Jesus in the same ways. We don't all pray the same way or expect the same things when we pray. We don't all vote the same or feel the same way about many issues. But we believe in each other and in the value of hearing and learning from each other. We believe that God calls us together. We believe that all creation is diverse and wonderful. We are an affirming community, which means that we are a safe and engaging place for all those who express their identity in the LGBTQ2S+ communities. That is lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, two-spirited. Our community will always include those who are non-binary, identify with other pronouns like they, them, and help to broaden our understanding of gender, identity, and God. We believe that we are all created in God's image, meant and empowered to reveal, receive, and share love. We believe that justice and respect are due to the peoples who were first here, thousands and thousands of years before any settlers arrived. People whose descendants are still here to this day, still sharing a rich culture, spirituality, respect for the land, and treaties that settlers have often neglected. Settlers came with an intent to colonize and not cooperate, and even though welcome to share the land, colonizers divided it and insisted on owning it. From colonial arrogance through residential schools and racist systems that persist, Indigenous peoples have not been treated as partners, equals, or people worthy of respect. We lament this and our part in it. We recognize that the land upon which Jubilee United Church sits is the traditional home of the Petun, the Wendat, the Anishinaabeg, Haudenosaunee, and Mississaugas of the Credit. We recognize that there is history, wisdom, and spirit that transcends borders beneath our very feet. We provide financial support to the Toronto Urban Native Ministry, and we are committed to reconciliation with our Indigenous siblings. We believe that one of our greatest challenges today is racism. Systemic, institutional, and often intentional. Jubilee is intentionally anti-racist, which doesn't mean that we yet fully appreciate the many perspectives that are part of our community, but we acknowledge a colonial perspective that can often miss the reality of diverse Black lives, Asian lives, and other lives that have been misrepresented, targeted, or ignored by those in positions of power. We stand with anybody who has been told that they do not belong. We lament our role in allowing racism to go unchecked, and we commit ourselves to equity, the true hope of equal opportunity, equal voice, and dignity for all people. We do this work imperfectly, but we do it because we believe that God is with us all, celebrated in the glorious diversity of humanity. We also believe that there is a place for you in this community. And we believe a whole bunch of other things, some fun, some serious, but all us. So here are some of the beliefs that we have been sharing lately. For the time being, Jubilee United Church remains closed for in-person worship. It won't be forever. But right now, this is the best way for us to love and protect our neighbors and ourselves. We are a dynamic community who trusts in God, a God who knows how to find us. We trust in a spirit that is always present. And we trust in Jesus, who teaches us how to live in the best of times, the toughest of times, and all of the times in between. We will continue to share in virtual worship, phone calls, notes, supportive actions, and prayers, and we appreciate all that you do to help connect with those who need it the most. As you have come to expect, Haley Brown will be hosting a check-in for kids and parents today at 2 p.m. The Zoom link is on the Jubilee website. And if you've never had a chance to experience what goes on at these Zoom gatherings, well, here's a little taste.
On this episode of Bible Storytime with Haley, we learn about the Holy Family.
Today we're going to talk about the Holy Family. Now, I wonder what part of the Holy Family is the most important part?
All of them.
All of them, yeah, maybe.
Or maybe like just like the donkey, Jesus, and the parents, Mary and...
Or maybe the angel. Maybe that's important. Mm-hmm.
Maybe.
The shepherds.
And the shepherds.
I think everybody's important in this story.
I wonder if there's anyone that we can leave out and still have the same story and have all we need.
Okay, but like, here. So if you think about it like this, so if we didn't have the shepherd, they wouldn't have a place to, you know, stay. Mm-hmm. If it weren't for the Mother Mary, everything wouldn't have happened, or without Joseph, because he helped a lot. Mm-hmm. And of course, without baby Jesus, those three people are very important. And the donkey, because, you know, it's hard to walk and stuff. Mm-hmm. And if they didn't have the star people, the magi.
Or you and your little one can sign up to join Haley live in the Jubilee Virtual Studio at the next session of Bible Storytime with Haley.
I remind you that we will be sharing in virtual communion next Sunday. So please plan to have some bread and juice, crackers and wine, tea and toast, whatever you have that can bring you into the moment of Jesus sharing his body and blood with us, with the whole world. And you know that I want pictures. I mean, any pictures are appreciated, but right now, well, for the next 3 days, I would love pictures of you with bread and juice, or biscuits and tea, or the simple elements that we need to celebrate communion, as interpreted by you. And if you're so inclined, and please be inclined, I would love an audio recording of you saying the Lord's Prayer, the way you like to say it, in English or in another language. I'd love to have another language. You can say forgiving our sins or forgiving our trespasses, whatever you prefer. I would just like to hear your Lord's Prayer. You can record it on your phone or on your tablet, on your computer, and send it to me. Just email it directly to me, and that would be fantastic. And like I said, we're celebrating communion next Sunday, so I really do need the communion pictures and the Lord's Prayer by Wednesday at the latest. Other pictures? Anytime. Keep them coming. And while you're at it, keep sending me limericks. We love limericks. And don't forget, I believe in 12 words or less. We're still going to do that for another couple of weeks. For those who are journaling, allow us to offer these prompts for the week. Name 3 things that you can't go without. And then tell yourself why you picked these 3. Describe what a great weekend was like when you were 10 years old. I got my income tax refund last week, and it was more than I was expecting. So I wrote a check to Jubilee, just a one-time special donation. In 2020, 2 special financial gifts actually made it possible for us to enter into this time of COVID and lockdown without having to cut back on staff or limit the way that we reach out and into the community all around us. People are including Jubilee in wills and bequests, And this gives us not just financial support, it also gives us confidence as we plan for the future. And I'm not talking about next week or even next year. I'm talking about the next generation and the one after that. I'm talking about children and grandchildren and being sure that a place like Jubilee, that Jubilee is there for them when they come looking for that special connection that people find here. Gifts to the Benevolent Fund have helped some folks who have been devastated by the pandemic and helped others who have just been burdened, weighed down in ways that they had never been before, but we've helped sort of lift them up just that little much more. People have discovered the ease of e-transfers and others have switched to PAR. Giving through Canada Helps and traditional checks in the mail have kept us not only economically viable, but like I said, they've inspired us to not be afraid and to search for new ways to share God's love in a new and always changing world. All of that has come from you, and we thank you. And yes, we encourage you to continue your support. Of course we do. But in this moment, we simply say thank you. Because of you, we know and we are able to share with others that we are not alone. We live in God's world. Thank you for all that you've done, all that you're doing, and all that you will do tomorrow. God bless you. As we often note in our opening acknowledgments, Jubilee United Church supports the Toronto Urban Native Ministry. Now, many of us are aware of the encampments around Toronto. You may also be aware that 15% of people experiencing homelessness in Toronto are Indigenous. Does it seem like 15% of our population are Indigenous? You may also appreciate that many Indigenous people struggle to trust the government or provide identification that is acceptable to government agencies. Well, on Wednesday, the Toronto Urban Native Ministry, with partners, ran a no-barrier COVID vaccine clinic for those without identification. There was no electronic tracking, just paper sign-up sheets. The plan was to provide 150 vaccines, but with the complete support of Toronto Health and our many partners and responding to the demand, Toronto Urban Native Ministry provided 600 vaccines.
Hey everybody, welcome to Toronto Urban Native Ministry's weekly drumming. This is Reverend Evan Swan Smith. You probably can't even see me because I'm in full PPE. I'm here at Church of the Holy Trinity because we have been running a COVID-19 vaccine clinic all day. We are getting very close to finish, but in partnership with Maggie's and I think it's Partners for Equitable Change and Public Health and lots of amazing people, we've managed to actually give out 600 doses of the Pfizer vaccine to community members in a no barriers clinic, which means that people were able to access, whether they had ID, whether they were undocumented, with no fixed address, no OHIP cards. It's been amazing. We're super proud of it. And so thank you to everybody who made this day possible. And to Sandra, who was out here busting her butt all day. And yeah, right there. I'm gonna go back in and help screen people, but I'm super grateful for our community and for all the support we have. And Sandra and Sue, I'm gonna turn it over to you now. Miigwech.
As I light the Christ candle, I celebrate the work of the Toronto Urban Native Ministry, providing needed support, harm reduction, traditional medicines and wisdom, drumming, ceremony, and Christian worship that is in harmony with Indigenous traditions for all people. This indeed is the light of Christ.
Then he said to them,
"These are the words that I told you when I was still with you. The law of Moses, the law of the prophets. Everything that was written must be fulfilled."
Cool.
Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them,
"Thus it was written, that Messiah must suffer and die and rise on the third day, and that repentance and the forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You have been witness to this, these things.
Cool.
I am sending upon you what my father promised.
Stay here in the city until you are be clothed with power."
Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them, and he was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him, and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they were continually in the temple, blessing God.
I know the hymn, it's Voices United, number 698, but I did not know about the man who actually wrote the words, Reverend Moon Ikwan. There is a wonderful 18-minute video tribute on YouTube from the Second Wind Archive on Reverend Moon Ikwan. Growing up in 20th century Korea, Ikwan believed in a united and independent Korea. When Korea was divided into North and South, his Christian faith cried out that God's land is not divided and God's people are not divided. And so he walked from the South to the North, from South Korea across the border into North Korea, ignoring the shouts of border guards and soldiers, turning his back to the guns and the tanks. He walked up and into the North to see his extended family. He embraced them and turned around and walked back South. And when he again crossed the border, he was greeted by crowds of supporters, but was also arrested and sentenced to 5 years in prison. Throughout his life, Ikwan fought for Korean unification, and he would be arrested 5 times and spend about 10 years in prison. The last time he went into North Korea was 1989. Again, he was arrested. He died in 1994. The words of this hymn fueled Ikwan's faith and ministry, and they are one of the many gifts that people of Asian heritage offer the United Church of Canada to fuel our faith and our ministry. I love being part of a family that includes Reverend Moon Ikwan and all of his siblings and extended family. There are no lines between God's children.
The wind.
The Book of Acts, chapter 1, verses 1 through 11, read by Cheryl Colford, who, by the way, just had a fabulous interview and has begun the process of becoming a minister in the United Church of Canada. Congratulations, Cheryl.
In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven.
Let us pray. Loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your eyes. And God, may I never lightly presume to preach your word. And may we never lightly presume to hear your word. For in your word is hope, truth, love, and abundant life. Amen. So I don't know what you've been doing with your free time, but thanks to lockdown, I have seen every superhero movie ever made. All of them. Absolutely each and every one of them, I have no doubt, including the 4.5-hour re-edit of Zack Snyder's Justice League. Yes, I watched that. And I'll be honest, it has some things to recommend it, but I think I still prefer my Superman. Henry Cavill is great and all as Superman. He's fantastic, but my heart still races when I hear,
"Look, up in the sky, it's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman. Yes, it's Superman, strange visitor from another planet who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Superman, who can change the course of mighty rivers, bend steel in his bare hands, and who, disguised as Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for a great metropolitan newspaper, fights a never-ending battle for truth, justice, and the American way."
Sound familiar? I mean, as you listen to the gospel today, do you ever wonder if they maybe cribbed Superman from Luke's gospel? I mean, think about it, right? The story of a strange visitor who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Jesus, who can change the course of mighty storms, feed 5,000 with his bare hands. Well, it is kind of like that, isn't it? And for those of you who love your superheroes, you know that Superman's name is Kal-El, and Jesus is Emmanuel. Same family? And that's the problem, some of my friends would say. The problem with the church and all of these stories that Christians insist on telling, they're too fantastical, too unbelievable, too supernatural. They're beyond us. It's like they're from another planet. I suppose there's something in that, but I gotta tell you, I think for many of us, these stories, they're not supernatural at all. In fact, they're extremely natural. These stories reveal the true nature of our lives. I mean, no matter what the parallels, I will insist that the Bible is not a comic book. It's not a movie. Jesus is not Superman. Not in anybody's edit. He just isn't. Let me explain it. So, first off, Superman was born on another planet. Right? He's an alien who came to love humanity. At first, it was just America he loved, but we've now he loves all of humanity. He disguises himself as a human, right? Puts on the glasses, and pretends to be just like us. And then from time to time, he slips into his jammies and adds a cape, and then he fixes the things that we can't fix. Superman. No matter what anybody tells you, that's not Jesus. Jesus was not born on another planet. Jesus became flesh here on earth, in the neighborhood, as it were. His mother was human and known to us. His father, okay, it's a little trickier there, granted, but it's clear from Luke's gospel that although the birth is miraculous, with angels and singing and all that stuff, Jesus is still fully human. Jesus is not like us, but actually the same as us. That's not Superman. And listen, I like Superman as much as the next guy, probably a little bit more than the next guy. But when I see bullets bouncing off of his chest or I watch him fly through the air, that tells me a lot about an alien from Krypton and tells me almost nothing about myself. The story of Jesus tells me about me. This story of the Ascension, the one we read today, it's only told by Luke. Matthew doesn't tell the story, Mark doesn't tell the story, John doesn't tell the story, and John loves big stories. But Luke tells the story. In fact, I would suggest to you that Luke needs to tell this story. just as I've been binge-watching superhero movies, perhaps you've been binge-watching Jubilee services lately. Could happen. And if you have, you may recall that just before Christmas, I think I mentioned that Luke's whole gospel is like a musical, at least to me. It's full of great sweeping dramatic moments that are begging for orchestras and costume changes and lots of lights and choreography and people on wires. Yeah. Yeah, that was a great sermon. It's Luke that gives us Mary bursting into song with the Magnificat upon realizing that she's going to be a mom. It's Luke that gives us the multitude of angels at Jesus' birth. Luke gives us the dramatic dialogue between Jesus and the two thieves at the resurrection. That's such a musical moment. And now the show-stopping finale. Luke gives us the big exit. Right? This is the moment where Luke just brings it all home. Bring him home. No, don't worry. I am not going to do that. The thing is, Luke wants us to suspend our disbelief for just a little while. He wants this story to act like a musical and let it slip in behind our rational mind and start us singing and crying and feeling. He wants this story to foster an emotional connection. He wants us to be spiritually informed more than intellectually supplied. You can get ideas anywhere. Luke wants you to have feelings. This gospel, at least this part of it, it's not an argument or a thesis. It is a grand finale, the final act. Right? It starts with the crucifixion. It builds to this glorious ascension up, 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 and away. And it reveals our true nature. Not Superman's, ours. Because Jesus is one of us. Not disguised as Clark Kent pretending to be one of us, but actually one of us. And what you need to know is that our lives, you and me, our lives will always run between crucifixion and ascension. We will always find ourselves between struggle and glory. The power of the one comes from the experience of the other. And our humanity includes both. Scratching your head a little bit right now? Okay. Let me go back to Superman for just a minute. You see, Superman always shows up when Lois Lane or Jimmy Olsen are getting in trouble. Right? He shows up when there is nothing that we regular folk can do to make things right. And so he stops the bad guy, he catches the falling plane, he even changes the weather. In short, he does all the things that we can't do. When disaster strikes, Superman fixes everything for us because we couldn't possibly do it without him. We just can't. It's not in our power. And I will admit that an awful lot of people seem to treat Jesus the same way. But I think that they're missing the point. At least the point that Luke is trying to make in this grand finale. We are presented here with Jesus, who is unjustly accused, beaten up, stripped naked, and crucified. Things like that don't happen to Superman, Superboy, Supergirl, or super people generally. It just doesn't happen if you're super. But things like that do happen to real people like me and you. All of us have had times of great vulnerability. We don't talk about them often. In fact, very often we do our best to forget about them because we don't like to feel vulnerable. We don't want to be vulnerable. We want to be Superman. And so we don't ask for directions. We're fine, thank you very much. We have all the answers. We don't need help. Our kids are perfect. Our parents are great. We are doing great in lockdown. Facebook is real life. But to be human is to be vulnerable. Think about the times when you've actually been vulnerable. Asking for directions got you there faster and safer, didn't it? Not knowing all the answers meant that you got to hear new ideas as they were shared with you, right? Not being fine helped you discover another person who shares your struggle. And suddenly, well, you may not have been fine, but you weren't alone. It's good to know that you're not alone. But let's go a little deeper. I remember in my early ministry, a young father dying of cancer. And I couldn't fix it. I didn't really know how to be a minister in the midst of this struggle. I didn't know what to do. For the last 3 months of this man's life, I have rarely felt so useless and so vulnerable. And it wasn't about me, and I was feeling that way. Imagine how everybody else was feeling in the midst of losing a son, a husband, a father, a brother. We knew when his last day was upon us. And so I spent the day not at the hospital, but at home with his son, 6-year-old, who was just not able to handle the hospital. And so I spent the afternoon there, and I remember getting the call and then sitting down with this little boy and telling him that his father had died. I won't tell you about the tears or what the two of us shared in that moment. That's between us. But I will tell you that I have rarely felt so humanly connected to someone. In the vulnerability, in the being emotionally bare, a bond is created. And this, although dramatic, was not a unique experience for me in my ministry or in my life since then. And I know that it's not mine alone. You know what I'm talking about, because you've been there too. As I told that story, another one struck you, didn't it? A moment where you've been there and experienced this. Vulnerable, emotionally bare. In these bonds that we create, there is, as if all of a sudden, understanding and patience and support. And although often born of shared struggle or hurt or pain, there is a benefit that is life-giving. You don't go to war with someone with whom you have a bond. You can't let injustice go unanswered when you are bonded to the victim. You would never let someone that close to you go hungry, right? Do you get what I mean now? Afraid, unsure, out of our element, not sure at all what to do, but willing to be human, that's real connection. That's love. And Superman has no idea what that's about. Physical intimacy can be like that too. And don't worry, I'm not going to discuss my sex life or anybody else's. But I will say that so often the problem with romance or physical intimacy on TV or in the movies is that they take the vulnerability away. Everybody is airbrushed and confident. There's no vulnerability. There's no worry, no mistakes, no laughter. I'll stop. Don't worry. But you know what I mean, right? Real connection happens in our shared vulnerability, not in our common expertise. Superman doesn't get that. He just doesn't understand. But Jesus does. So does Luke when he tells the story. Luke presents for us a naked and vulnerable Jesus. And that vulnerability is not a sign of failure. It's the key to his success. And then having shared that, he exits. Not stage right, not stage left, not into the sunset. Up, up, up into heaven with his body. With his body. And that's actually really important to me. He took his body. He didn't slip out of it and leave it behind the way that Superman takes off his glasses and his tie, right, to leave Clark Kent behind. He doesn't discard his body, no. He doesn't discard his body because we're not meant to discard our humanity. We're meant to embrace it. We're meant to revel in it. We're meant to use it. It's not Jesus' divinity that changes the world. It's Jesus' humanity. The very humanity that he shares with us. And so if we take the story seriously, if we really pay attention to the ascension, we understand that we too can change the world. We may not be able to go up, up, up by ourselves, but we can make a difference here. We're not meant to sit around waiting for Jesus or Superman to fix the world. We're meant to be part of the world, part of the fixing of the world. Think of Scripture. God doesn't act alone. God nearly always invites engagement. God doesn't write words in the sky. God introduces God's self to Abraham. Let's have a covenant. God doesn't send a boat. God tells Noah how to build one. God doesn't just write down the rules. God becomes present to us in Jesus and shows us what the rules look like when they are lived, when they are expressed in loving action. And Jesus doesn't do it alone either. He gathers friends to help. We are always invited to be in this with God, not waiting to be saved by Superman bursting through the wall, but being actively involved. That's what we do. Not denying our humanity or wishing that we could be something better, but embracing our humanity and using it to actually make a difference, actually change the world. So now comes the moment when I reveal that I'm not Luke. I mean, you probably already realize that at my age and all, but I am keenly aware that I'm not Luke because, well, unlike Luke, I don't have a big finish for the sermon. There's no orchestral swell. The whole cast isn't going to come out and sing Welcome to the Rock. I'm not going to defy gravity as I fly off. No big wrap-up to bring it home. Bring it home. No, I said I wouldn't do that. But I can't imagine the folks standing around watching Jesus go up, up in the air. Up and away, and then bringing their eyes back down to earth and looking at each other. Here we are, and wondering, now what? It's not a big finish, I know, but maybe the answer has already been revealed. Now what? Dare to be vulnerable. Dare to be broken and hurting with one another. Recognize that it is our humanity that brings us closer to God. So don't sit around waiting for Superman, and don't sneer at yourself and imagine how much better you could be if only. Just be. It's enough. It's enough. And now, like a good musical, allow me to add a coda, a theme you've already heard earlier in the show. In these bonds that we create, as if all of a sudden there is understanding and patience and support. Because you don't go to war with somebody with whom you have a bond. You can't let injustice go unanswered when you are bonded to the victim. And you would never let someone that close to you go hungry. It all starts when we dare to be vulnerable. And it lifts us all. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the stories that affirm our humanity. Remind us that you love us for our humanity. Love us so much that you engage in our humanity that we might know not only are we not alone, but that we can make a difference. We can change the world. God, be with us as we dare. Comfort us when we hurt. And encourage us always to be the human beings that you created us to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Holy One, you know us as a God who has come to us loving among us, laughing among us, teaching among us, weeping among us, grieving among us, in a body like so many other bodies. Delicate flesh molded to rigid bones, a body that experiences the warmth of a delicate touch, and the pain inflicted with violent hands, who knows what it means to be human within this beautiful but imperfect world. And so you know, we humans can be complicated creatures. Our minds are not always open to understanding. We do not always understand our role as witnesses to your calls and your world. But here together in this time and this space and this place, we come together in prayer for those spirits, those bodies, those beloveds scattered far and wide who are in need of love. And we are all in need of love. We pray for the families of the 44 civilians and 139 government forces killed in Afghanistan this past week, the highest death toll in a single week since mid-autumn 2020. We pray for those in Cambodia as 300,000 residents cannot leave their homes to get food, at the same time NGO groups are barred from entering to distribute aid. We pray for India, Sri Lanka, the Maldives, Indonesia, Thailand, Cambodia, and Nepal as COVID surges and health systems are reaching breaking points. God, we pray that you will provide those grieving the deadly assaults in Gaza and East Jerusalem that have killed over 50 people and wounded hundreds more, the comfort and healing that words cannot. We pray for an immediate end to the violence in Gaza and East Jerusalem, and for a just peace in Palestine and Israel. We pray for those living within indigenous communities, demanding clean water, defending their lands, defying colonial imposition of treaty rights and the ability to lead a healthy and self-determined existence. We pray for those of us who experience the ongoing weight of systemic injustice, those of us who are queer, those of us who are Black or Asian, those of us who live with disability, those of us who disrupt the status quo, who insist on the right to rise up, just as Christ did, just as Christ does, over and over again. We pray for those who are working on the front lines of this pandemic, the PSWs, the nurses and doctors, the street outreach workers. And God, we especially give thanks for the work of Toronto Urban Native Ministry and their partners who vaccinated 600 vulnerable people in a barrier-free clinic this week. 600 people who did not need ID or an address, who only needed to show up and receive care. Finally, God, we know that you know what it means to live a human life. And we know that you know how your people crave to be in community. And so we pray for those of us in this ongoing COVID time who are lonely, who are grieving, who are yearning to be held and hugged, or perhaps even just seen, who have been cooped up and bogged down, perhaps just going through the motions day in and day out. We pray for those in need of love, and we are all in need. And God, because we know that you know what it means to live a human life, we know that you understand, that you hear us, that you comfort us, and all our siblings, and all our neighbors, close by and further on.
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
go forth from this moment and don't be afraid to be exactly who you are. Human, vulnerable, often doubting, often worried, and yet powerful and lovable. Go into the world and be all of those things and know that God, the Creator, is with you. Know that Jesus walks with you and lifts you when you fall. And know that the Holy Spirit absolutely surrounds and fills each and every one of us. Until we gather again virtually or one day in person. Amen.
The disciples are going crazy.
Ah, yeah.
This is joy.
Joy!